morning, everybody.
Hello.
It's a happy Wednesday morning. When you hear that music, that means it's time for Idiotic.
It is. Let's get idiotic.
Well, let's do it.
Let's do it. Here we are. Hey, wait a minute. Get idiotic. That's our default position, isn't it?
That's the default zone we like to be in.
We have to work hard to get out of that zone.
Man, Chris, hey, we've got a new guest with us today.
We do indeed. Welcome to Bianca Baumann. Welcome to Idiotic.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Our pleasure. Our pleasure. So we have an official topic today, ruthlessly relevant. How can we engage the modern learner? But maybe before we jump into that too far, give us a short bio of yourself and a little bit of info to help folks know who you are.
Absolutely. Bianca Baumann, as now everyone knows, currently working as the Director of Learning Experience Design at GP Strategies. And I love everything that has to do with looking outside of our little L&D world and see where we can get inspiration from. For me, that's specifically marketing. So I do talk about that a lot. I blog about that. I actually just released an ebook about that, which I'm super stoked about. So I'll definitely share the URL there for you to download. And it's a practical guide. So it's not just, hey, here's what you can do. It actually walks you through how to do it in true learning fashion. So yeah, that's me.
Very cool.
Yes.
Very, very cool. And good morning to everybody in the chat. We've got lots of good mornings and hellos and heyos going on in there. So, and as always, folks, don't forget to use that chat to toss in any questions that you've got as we go. We like to turn this into as much of a conversation as we can. So this topic, the ruthlessly relevant, how can we engage the modern learner? And I'll say up front, this is my earworm thing. Whenever I hear the phrase modern learner, I hear David Bowie's Modern Love, and more particularly the line, I don't believe in modern love, which I then transpose to, I don't believe in modern learners. So.
Right. I love that intro. I really do. Because before we actually went live, it's like, yeah, what does that even mean? What is the modern learner, right? I'm sure we've all seen that little infographic that tells us about the attention span and, you know, everyone wants to be on these. And it's interesting because at GP, we actually have a survey, Voice of the Learner, that we sent to like 3,000 or 4,000 people. And you know what happened? The younger generation, they actually don't want training on their phone. They actually do prefer live training. And I thought that was quite interesting, right? So, wow. And I'm not saying that the research on the modern learner that's out there is, you know, totally off, but there is other research out there that suggests, you know, it might not just be everything about the mobile device, right? So, yeah.
We certainly, I think, are susceptible to making assumptions based on a few observations that can very, in our practice, can get translated into de facto, you know, rules, I feel.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And then it almost seems like, you know, the next big thing you want to hold on to because, well, we're not quite sure what we're doing. So, oh, modern learner, that sounds great. Let's, you know, follow that for a while and see what happens. Right. So I almost feel that that's the case. And then everything all of a sudden has to be mobile. But then what we realize, and I think we're all in the same boat, you know, you go out there and suggest, hey, you know, we could have some apps that help you do your training and your coaching and, you know, and whatnot. And then the client goes, that's great, but we don't have mobile devices and we don't allow our staff to use their own. So can we just have an e-learning module? Right. So it's kind of that, you know, how do we bring that together, that, you know, that need or possible need of, you know, more mobile, and then, you know, there's no option to actually deliver it on a mobile.
Yeah, I recall having a project once and talking to a client who just said, you know, basically, yeah, no, they're not allowed to even hook up to the Wi-Fi. So now we have to consider if they're going to do something, are we going to pay for their cell service and, you know, for the data, their bandwidth and stuff too. So yeah, there's always complications, even though in the larger world, we think we see a pattern of everybody on the device. It may not always be an option or a thing. So do you have like a thumbnail definition for yourself when you think about what a modern learner is then?
You know what? No, because for me, it really depends on the organization we're working with, right? Because a modern learner for one organization is possibly on their device and they do the whole AR and VR thing. Whereas in another organization, you know, modern learner means, oh, we actually never really done e-learning. And, you know, this is brand new to us. And this is what modern learning is for me. One great example we had recently, we had a client come to us and say, well, you know, we want you to help us build all these e-learnings. We're like, this is great. And so we kind of, you know, asked the questions, the usual questions around who's your target audience. We went actually a little deeper. We did learner personas to really understand, you know, who their learners are. And then we said, well, you know, you have different options even when it comes to e-learning. You can have your traditional, you know, next slide kind of thing, the storylines of the world, or, you know, you can use more of like a vertical scrolling, like frameworks that are out there now, right? And the client said, oh, you know what? We don't have too much e-learning. Our learners are not used to this. I think we should do the traditional. And I said, well, but meaning, you know, the slide by slide. I said, okay, can I challenge that for a moment? Because if your learners are not used to e-learning, they're used to browsing the internet. And what do we do on the internet? We scroll vertically, right? Yeah. And just with that, the client goes like, oh, yeah, that makes sense. Let's use a framework instead, right? And now we just rebuild basically the website, because that's what they're used to, into a framework and build e-learning that way. So it really depends. So sorry if someone wanted a definition.
one person's cutting edge 21st century solution is another person's old school, right? So, you know, to your point about that, it's like the different businesses. This is why we have to get so much better at, or I think talk more about doing analysis first when we walk into a company or when we're looking at a business or trying to figure out what the solution is, because you're right. It, you know, I've been saying this for a long time that in a lot of situations, you might walk into a company thinking you're going to do e-learning. And what you realize is, you know what, we really need to be doing the classroom training that you're doing right now. And it doesn't need to change. Maybe we can support it a little bit with some tech. But in this particular instance, what you guys are doing is fantastic, and it works great. There's no reason to change it up.
Absolutely. And Chris made a comment there earlier too, that, you know, we assume that, you know, we want these, but think about yourself when you are on your mobile. Are you really engaged, or are you just killing time because you're in the grocery lineup waiting? Right. And I think that's what we have to think about too for our learning. It's like, yes, we are on these devices, but more and more as you read these articles and research, the word engagement for me is a little iffy, because yes, we're on it, but I don't think we're really engaged. Again, we're just killing time 80% of the time. I don't know, putting a number there, but.
Yeah. I mean, think about your social media feeds. You're scrolling through them, but you are at some point maybe selectively stopping, but you're, you know, blitzing past the vast majority of, or in most cases, the vast majority of something like that. So you maybe something might catch your eye, but you're not really, your surface, you're at a surface level, you know, in that kind of a model, just, you know, doing the thing to fill the time. So.
Well, and we often use those stats and things like that, like all the learners are on their phones all this number of times. And to your point, like, you know, the people are engaged on their phones when they're standing in the queue at the grocery store. And it's like, well, really, just because we see a lot of people on their phones and just because they're using them a lot doesn't mean they want to take their e-learning, even if we make it micro, people, you know, even if you make it a 60-second learning nugget. Right. Doesn't mean that's what they're going to be their go-to. They're standing in the grocery line going, what I'd really like to do right now is e-learning.
Yeah, exactly. And I love the micro piece there too, right? Like there's a place for it. Absolutely. Do I love shorter learning pieces? I think we all do. It has to do with a lot of different things, such as, you know, the busy environment we live in, hence ruthlessly relevant, right? Like what's the content we really need? Where can we cut? But, yeah, it's there's a place for the micro, and we really got to figure out where that is and where that sits, because in the end, what we do is about performance outcomes. And if the micro doesn't achieve the performance outcomes, yes, the learning is sexy and it's great and it's awesome and it's short, but did we actually change the behavior? Did we actually get to where we needed to be, right?
Yeah.
I think with that idea of smaller things too, we also run the risk of it not actually being anything more than surface. If something is brief and short, in the same way that moving it from short-term retention into actually long-term retention and then, behavioral change or changes to practice, I think there's a risk then in, if something really short and small, it's trivialized to a certain degree, maybe, potentially. I don't know. Yeah. I'm not a doctor, but this is...
We play one on Idiotic.
That's right.
Don't quote us. But yeah, I agree, right? And then it obviously it comes back to that whole repetition piece, right? If you really want it in your long-term memory, we've got to space it out and, have the option to repeat it different ways. Like, don't watch the same micro video over and over because, you just get bored. I don't think it really does. Right, but that's where it comes back to us as designers to say, okay, what is the content that's really needed? Where can I cut down? And I think that's where I would personally look at to marketing and say, okay, marketing, they use a content strategy, right? Meaning they really start planning out, they really look at what content really drives something, whatever that something is, and then cut it down and slice it up and then, have those multi-touch campaigns. But I think that's something we should look at much, much more is that content and pushback as well. If, clients come to us and say, I have all this content, it's like 2 hours of content and you have to, make me an e-learning module out of this. It's like, okay, there's 2 hours of content. Do you really need 2 hours of content?
I liked your phrase "ruthlessly relevant" that you used a few minutes ago.
Mm-hmm. How do we get ruthless though? Like, let's dig into that word too. I mean, why not? Right? What's the difference between just being relevant and being ruthlessly relevant?
For me, it's when you, as a consultant, get slightly uncomfortable asking the client again if they need that piece of content, you're on the right track. Right? Because we all know that we should ask the questions around the content. And then, we also know we get to this point where we're like, okay, I think I pushed enough. I'll just leave it at that. Yeah. Just push a little more. And then once more, and then another time. And then I think you are where you want to be when it comes to being ruthlessly relevant, because again, everyone is so busy, if it's on the mobile or on a laptop or a desktop, but to keep it short at the same time, focusing obviously on the performance outcomes, I think that's where the truth is there, where we really have to ask those tough questions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Dana, so Dana, question.
Go ahead, go for it, Brent. I was going to say the same thing.
Were you going to? Oh, okay.
Go for it.
Great minds.
Idiotic minds.
Idiotic minds. We're all on the same page. So I'll read it, and then you can respond. Dana says, isn't this deluge of mobile micro learning offerings largely driven by commercial interests more than by actual interest in stronger learning impacts?
Yeah, I would say yes, right? And it comes back to what we were just saying a couple of minutes ago. Yeah, it's sexy. It looks good. It sells well, right? But yeah, does it really sell to the learner? Does it really make a difference to the learner? Maybe, maybe not, right? And I'm not disregarding any, of those little sexy, trailers, for example, to promote the training that you have out there, right? And if you think of multi-touch point campaigns that we could roll out instead of the one-time learning event, I think that's where these little microbursts come in really, really handy, because it's just a little bit of a promo. It can be repetition. It could be, just kind of summarizing things and helping to apply the knowledge in the workplace. So, yeah, I agree with Dana's comment.
I think that one of the risks I've always worried about with micro learning pieces is the need for continuity or the need for something to be actually a holistic experience. We can take something that might be 1 hour of a traditionally learning course, and we're going to deliver it in five, short bursts or 10 short bursts. But if you need to make connections and build, then you've now got a gap, you've got memory loss, lack of connectivity in that way. So that's one of my concerns about micro learning, that it doesn't really build, it doesn't replace potentially the same ability for someone to actually learn something deeply potentially. So
Absolutely. Also, if you take a 1 hour course and just chop it up into, 10 smaller pieces, you still have the same content. It's just, right?
Yeah. You're giving the illusion of compactness or concision, but it's not really there. Yeah.
So. I like that word illusion. Yeah. That's really
Well, we do lots of things in this business that we for fragmentary reasons we feel make sense or something, but then if you step back, was there a I see Q tossing in a comment about the mug. It's Dana followed up, some may help to stimulate or nudge a viewer toward a helpful learning resource or experience, but the rest is distracting noise, and we certainly have a potential for creating lots of noise as well in what we do. So let's just see. Joseph tossed in another comment. Micro is a term that markets itself, like agile. Yep. Yeah, it sounds logical, right? Agile. Who wouldn't want to be agile? Oh, you know what? We have a clumsy development process. We're proud of that. We're awkward. We're awkward. We follow the awkward model. Yes,
dude. Are there workshops on the awkward model, Chris?
Yeah, exactly. I'm going to trademark that right now. We're going to trademark awkward, TM. Regardless of what it actually means or achieves, it just sounds good and appeals to senior leaders making purchasing decisions. Yeah, it does. It often does, for sure.
And I think that's a really good point, right? That I said earlier, it sells well, right? So when clients come to us, they hear about the gamification and they hear about the micro and they hear about, whatever else is floating out there right now. And I think it's our responsibilities as consultants to say, well, yes, in, here's how you could possibly use this, or with all due respect, no, and here's why, right? To really, really make a good case there. And keep the learner in mind. I think that's what we keep on forgetting, it seems like, right? It's like, what does the learner think about this? And we're actually working with a client right now, and I'm so stoked because they do, I think, 2 weeks of user testing on one e-learning module, like usability testing. I'm like, wow, like that's, for me, that's unheard of, right? Mm-hmm. But the client understands how important this step is. And we hardly do that. We just put our training in front of people, either e-learning or face-to-face. And then after we ask, so how was your experience? And we just move on, right? Yeah. We don't really
Next
do anything.
Project.
So, exactly. So it's nice to get those usability tests in early to really, engage the learner. And I know it's not always possible, is what I hear, but then I would ask why.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Because they didn't think of it. It's not part of the initial planning, and then therefore it's a bounce. It's a variation and et cetera. Yeah. What are then, I guess, if we can just flip back to the official, content, the official title, how can we engage the modern learner? I think we've talked a fair bit now about things that we don't think are necessarily true about something called a modern learner, but are there still things that we should be doing about that at that engagement level?
Yeah, I still believe that our attention spans are shorter and shorter. So kudos to everyone who's here for an hour. But there is something to be said about shorter learning, what that short is. And I think it depends on the environment the learner is in. It depends on what they're already used to. It depends on their expectations and, for me, again, I always like to take the page out of the marketing playbook. And one thing that marketing does really well is writing. They write very precisely, where goes back to ruthlessly relevant. And I think we can really learn something from marketing around writing good copy and even writing, course titles. There's headline, do you call it? Headline software or programs out there that, you can actually go in and type in your headline or course title and you get a little score for it. I totally geek out over that. I'm always trying to get a higher score, right? You can use those headline analyzers for course titles as well, because I think often we don't even think about the course title. We're just like, oh, here's the content, and we're just calling it the introduction to, the ergonomics module in the office environment. I don't know. Something ridiculous that, every learner will see that and they'll go, okay, here we go again. You know, let's open up another screen and just click that next button.
Watch a little YouTube while we're clicking through this course.
That's right. That's right. Because conveniently, the next button is grayed out for whatever strange reason. So, so I think, you know, starting at that course title and writing precise copy is one. And I'm just going to stop here because I'm sure there's some comments. I see them popping through. I want to see if there's comments from you guys.
Well, I think for me, the big part to go along with that, writing well, Patty Schenck has a fantastic book out that she just released. I think it was last year, so maybe it's not that new, but her latest book in her series of books that she's done is about writing for e-learning. And it's extremely well-written. Patty does good work. She writes good stuff, very well-researched. And, you know, so it's important. And a lot of times I don't think, you're right, I don't think we focus enough on our writing and our copywriting, right? Doing it like the marketers do. And, you know, I think there's a few people out there that have similar sort of quotes, and I'll probably butcher them all. But, you know, the basic effect of the idea is, you know, only like cut everything down to just what's necessary to make the learning point or to make it easy, right? Like how much of it can you take away and still be left with something that is useful for learning or impactful or engaging, right? And I think it's a fun little exercise, if nobody's ever done that, to just take something you've written and just start taking the words out or putting new words in, or how short can I write this sentence and still have it be impactful, right? And it's, you know, that's the kind of stuff we don't really focus on, right? How often do we talk about good writing in e-learning? Hardly ever, because we're always talking about how to build the best graphic and build the best PowerPoint and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But writing is critical.
Absolutely. And I do understand. No, I'm sure, go ahead. Oh, sorry. I'm sure there's a lot of people saying, oh, you know, we have compliance and all these words need to be in there. I agree and I disagree, because there's parts of it that can be in the module itself, but guess what? Link out to a PDF. If you have them read only, why do you have them read in an e-learning module, right? And then the other thing that goes hand in hand with this is actually at the end, there's our beloved knowledge check. Oh, you pass if you, you know, get 80%. Well, on a second, that means if you don't know 20%, you still pass. So why do we even add those 20% in that we're testing? Like, it makes absolutely no sense to me, right? So maybe you could start from there.
Kind of. I think about the review process, and like you were mentioning, the language that sometimes people feel needs to be there. But when we do, when you've made something and you put it to, you know, the review group, making that concision, that recognition that where can we pair as an active part of the review process is something we probably don't often actually do. You know, it's more of a content review as opposed to, but if you can make it an actual stated explicit, I guess that's the word I'm struggling to find this morning, make it an explicit aspect of that review process. I mean, you're talking about marketing. Well, websites are built by, you know, lots of people together, and they can somehow come down to an agreement that, you know, here's the things that we can focus on or trim. So being able to make that an explicit part of the review process, for instance, that, look, what can we do, as opposed to simply confirming that the words are all spelt right, or, you know, and a lot of this is out of our control, because sometimes the legal team takes a whirl through it and they say, well, here's what we have to do to protect, you know, for risk mitigation, et cetera. So we're not always capable of doing that, but it is something that we don't, as I think about various projects, not often do we tell people to say, okay, part of the review goal here is let's get rid of 10% of the words or something, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's where design reviews come in really, really handy. And I use the word design and not instructional design, because it would probably include everything. But yeah, we are actually using a very simple checklist. We call it a peer review. And, you know, someone on the team goes through whatever, you know, someone created. And we have different sections. And one of them is language and words and, you know, looking at that copy itself, not just the typos. I really, you know, agree with you there, Chris, that, yeah, just make it part of your review process and have a checklist. It's as simple as that, so people realize, oh yeah, I should, you know, think about this.
Sometimes it's driven too, because you're handed a storyboard And the person has, in creating the storyboard, has already envisioned the experience overall. Whereas, and that robs us often as instructional designers of being able to simply say, okay, what are the best ways to, you know, provide some information around this, or et cetera. You know, you're handed a PowerPoint from the SME who's, this is what we do. Okay, now we're just going to electrophonicize it, as opposed to actually design something, you know, better out of it too. So lots of structural, and we know that every organization struggles with these at different kind of, you know, at different levels for sure.
What we actually started doing is our design document in most cases is not a heavy Word document anymore. It's actually a visual PowerPoint to really have the client focus on the flow, the takeaways, activities that would happen, and less so on the actual content. And it works actually surprisingly really, really well. You know, where initially there was actually some pushback, even internally. It was like, you can't do this. Like, you know, the SMEs need to see the content and that's not going to work. I'm like, oh, they'll see it. They'll see it at the storyboard phase. But at that point, we already have their buy-in into the experience and they actually worry a little less about the wording. So you might want to try that. It works well. Not all the time. There's clients that still want, you know, the traditional, but we're starting to push those boundaries. And also getting the visuals in early in the design document stage allows us to not have this what experience at the storyboard phase was like, I didn't think it would look like this. Right. So
Brent, you want to scan through the questions or the comments and see if there's lots going on there. Holy cow.
A couple of good ones, but I'm almost afraid to approach them, but I do think it's hilarious. So I just have to share Kara's comment from an old boss of hers that said, it's e-learning. It's like a skirt, long enough to cover everything, but short enough to keep it interesting. And I, whoever your boss is, Kara, can we quote her? Because I was feeling a little uncomfortable about it until you said it was a woman, and that made me feel a little bit better. But still, I'm thinking in this day and age, might have to report her to HR. I'm not sure, but anyways, but it's a great visual, if nothing else, for that whole thing.
None of us will forget that comment today. It went straight from short-term into long-term memory.
That's what we need to be doing more of in our learning, right? And it's one of the things that I was going to mention was, you know, because Dana also drops in, learning is change, as we all know. And yes, but something that we also forget, I think, is that change often comes from being uncomfortable and sometimes even a little bit of pain. And us, you know, e-learning people, training people, we're givers. We like to make people feel good. We want people to succeed and all of that. And it makes us uncomfortable to make them uncomfortable. But if you really want learning and change to occur, a lot of times you have to act and think like a game developer, because game developers push people over that edge to that edge of being just uncomfortable enough to feel like, oh, I want to try again, but yet not so uncomfortable that they feel like they'll never win and they quit. So you're always, we need to find that same balance that those game developers find, but not be shy about pushing a little bit and saying, yeah, this is going to be hard and it's going to make you work. It's going to make you think.
I like that comment. And I think we're all used to the beautiful, beautiful compliance courses, right? Where you just click through, you don't even use your brains because you've done it the last 5 years. If you're in the same organization, you already know the answers to the tests. Like, right? Like, don't tell me that, you know, yeah, this helps check the box. I get that part. But really, did they learn something, right? And that's where, again, comes back to that ruthlessly relevant. Like, what did they actually learn? Did we actually make a difference? And I really like how you put that there, Brent, that, you know, let's push them a little bit. Like, you know, because that's, if you think about going to the gym, right? Like, you could go to the gym and do the same exercises over and over and over. You come home, you feel pretty good about yourself. But if you really want to grow those muscles, right? Like, you got to mix it up and you got to change it up. And that's the same with learning, right? If we get hammered in the same things over and over and over, nothing really changes. So comfortably pushing.
No pain, no gain.
That's a good thing to do.
Yeah, I was going to make the same dad joke. Yeah. So I sometimes think of the those compliance courses that, you know, that we all have to take. I think of them sometimes as the phrase, you know, locks only keep the honest people out. In other words, everybody's taking compliance, but if you're not an honest, ethical person, to begin with, then going through a half an hour e-learning module and passing the quiz is not going to actually change your behavior or actually improve your behavior in that way. One of the things about psychopaths is that they learn to model normal behavior and game the system by pretending to have those normal behaviors. So why would we expect unethical people to, fail the quiz,
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And I think that's, again, where it comes back to what are the performance outcomes? What do we want them to do differently? And then go from there and build the training, right? And really make it more into, where they would use it every day. So maybe it's not even an e-learning module that they have to log into their LMS to go to, right? I mean, the brain really, learns best, or you remember best if, whatever you're learning, and when you're retrieving it later, it's the same environment. Well, no one is retrieving learning on the LMS, right?
It is that place for compliance. And someday maybe we might get there where we get people to jump in and get stuff more quickly and easily in the LMS. And I think it happens in certain places, in certain ways, but it's certainly not mainstream yet.
No, and you know what I'm hoping for? I mean, I'm not a big fan of the LMS, but I do understand why we have it, and I don't see it going anywhere anytime soon because of the compliance piece. But we're doing so many other training offerings and solutions that do not have to sit on the LMS, right? And it's the default almost that we'll go to. It's like, oh yeah, it has to be, an e-learning module and it needs to be 20 minutes long. It's like, okay, but there's so many other options of engaging the learner. It could be, a simple email campaign. It could be really read a blog, right? Like, yeah, so many options. Start thinking outside that LMS box a little bit.
Yeah, you mentioned earlier about us being an hour episode, and the truth is we're all about micro learning. So, because we only target a half an hour or so. We're practicing what we're actually criticizing. Wait a minute. No, preaching.
Wait.
I like it.
No, we love it. No, let's give us, can you, I have written some very cool things about this particular topic and all that kind of stuff. Give us, before we wrap up, just sort of some highlights and some bullets for folks to take away, if you will. Like, if we're talking about engagement and somebody is going to be thinking this through, what are like the top 3, 4, or 5 things that you would say this is going to point you in the right direction?
Yeah. Talk to your learner. Right, not just a sneeze. I know they always say they know what the learner wants. Do they really? So that would be one thing for me, the usability piece. The other thing is also, asking those questions that make you as a consultant uncomfortable, right? To really cut down the content. Really look at, different marketing techniques. I dropped in a couple: content strategy, multi-touch campaigns, writing good copy. So I think for me, those would be the top 3 things to look at. And I'm just going to put the link here.
I forgot to say, you got to drop some links in for sure.
Just want to make sure here that it's right. Take a look at that. It's, really like a guide of like how you could use it in your organization. You don't have to read it from front to back. You can just pick a chapter and say, oh, I like this about, content strategy, or I like the campaign approach. So just try something new. Don't be afraid. And, also, I think, remember that clients come to us, and I say clients, I mean external and internal, doesn't really matter. They come to us because they trust us. They know we're the experts. So be the expert, right? And be out there and help the learner, right? Because that's in the end what we're here for, right? Like, at least for me, that's why I got into
that's
this.
That's what we do. That's what we love to do.
We are a helpful bunch, aren't we? Or we try to be.
I think most of the time.
Yeah.
It depends on who's asking.
Yeah.
Most of the time.
Yeah, Jeff's got a link as well that he threw in about 20 questions to ask before talking about learning objectives. And so that's another thing that maybe we can check out. Jeff, we'll take a peek at that and see too. Yeah, Dane is throwing in, keep a focus on learning as much more than knowing. This training field has been stuck in knowing transfer and not learning impact. Yeah, and there's been some comments prior as well, you know, about making sure that people are actually performing something as part of the, you know, the work, as opposed to simply passively, you know, listening or passively pushing the next button.
It's not active.
More than next. But... Yeah. Jeff's also throwing in focusing on the applying of things. So lots of things there in the comments too to for people to jump off to. So cool. Bianca, thanks so much for joining us here today. We'd love to have you back in the future. I think there's lots of angles to this that we can explore. I'm even thinking about like interface design maybe in the future as a conversation.
Oh, so, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. Cool. All right, everybody. Thanks so much for your time this week.
That's our cue. Bye, Bianca. Thanks for hanging out with us.
Thank you.
Yeah, have a great day, everybody.
Bye.